Prem Namaste, Vanakkam and good morning. I am Shridhika Pillai and you are watching 3's newest magazine program, Sadhna, The Inward Path. Yes, it's exciting times as we delve deeper into the ocean of Hinduism to explore and unfold the pearls of this ancient religion. We begin today's show by examining the ideals of the idol, where we travel to the heart of India and examine an age-old tradition. We also head off to exotic Thailand and uncover a little known secret. And then we drop anchor in good old Mzansi with the sights and sounds of a spectacular firewalking prayer right here in Stanga. Hinduism highlights the omnipresence of the divine, both in the animate and inanimate, and idols form an integral part of worship, leading the devotee on from the form to the formless ultimate divine. Mahabalipuram in the south of India is home to a rich lineage of simple sculptors who very tangibly move the formless to an impeccable, precise form, where the divine is revealed quite literally as God in a stone.
Mystical Mother India, with her vibrant culture, incredible places of worship, and ancient traditions, appears mesmerizing to the ardent spiritual seeker and eager globetrotter alike. The pristine beauty of her grand palaces and forts contrasts sharply with the equal beauty of her quaint old villages that seem caught in time. In fact, the key to the mysticism is a similar theme of spiritual iconography that's infused throughout this ancient land. Mahabalipuram, lying on the Coromandel coast overlooking the Bay of Bengal, has its place in India's rich history. The village, often referred to as an open-air museum, with monolithic temples and impressive cave cutouts fashioned from a single rock, reflects its link to distant lands, as told through the artistic creativity and skill of its people, through to the present day.
This is my father. My grandfather doing same work. Then I am learned for college for sculpture 8 years. Theory, how is Ganesha, how is Vishnu, how is Kali, the different position, iconographic, iconometric.
Through the precision of the sculptor, a formless granite stone gradually takes shape to reveal the beautiful image of divinity. Idols are not the idle fancies of sculptors, but a medium, a channel through which the heart of a devotee connects to God. With the mind fixed on this image and the lips chanting the name, the heart of the devotee wells up with love and a divine connection is established.
I feel very good work for this because all the people is many people in all the world because nobody do it for granite work and also nobody do it for sculpture. I feel very good because I do drawing, I sculpture. I make for sculpture, I introduce for every time new sculpture. The client say I want Amman. So I ask him, how is this Amman? This is Santam or Kobam? Santam means smiling face. Kobam means it's for angry mood. Yeah, this is a big thing. Then we also doing drawing. They will telling for Ayidam. Ayidam means this hand, how is it? Abhayam, Astam. Abhay means like this. Yeah, Varada means like this. This is Chinmuttira. This is Susyastam. This is different position of gods. We make first highs and make center line. And then we make draw all the highs, nose, lips, then chin, everything we can draw. Then you can eat slowly. It will come into our face. When I buy stone big, not smaller, the client asking this size I need. So we can make for line first, you take first measurement, then I red marking. All the statues I have my mind. So what I look the stone, okay, this stone is okay for doing for that sculpture. Because if we hit the stone, it will come in for like bell sound. You see the bell in the temple? The sound that will coming for very long sound. This is very good stone. Granite is very good, cooling, very good weather, temperature is very good, you can put heat no problem, cold no problem. You see all the temple in the maybe 7th century and like that, and all the temple doing for only for stone. That time with any problem, the people go inside, they will safe because they want some time, they love tsunami, some cyclone, rain season, sometimes it will collapse, the temple nothing, nobody do it, no problem, because this is stone, very hard. We have nine faces for the god, nine faces, like this is for one face, okay. You can calculate your hand like this. 8 for you, for me, have our hand. This is for one face. Exactly, this is one face. You can calculate like this. 8 faces for human bodies. Then God is one step more. So we can calculate for 9. Ganesh is for 5 faces. Panjamukham. This is for Ganesha. Ganesha only for short. And Shiva, Vishnu, and 9.
A murti in the temple or home is precious for a devotee and is more than just an image of his Lord. Through his sadhana and penance, he lives its ideal, and verily, it is God for him. Indeed, more than just a god in a stone.
Bye.
Exotic Thailand, known mostly for its shopping and sun-soaked sandy beaches, actually has some similarities to our own South African history. Indians here also played a phenomenal role in this country's history as well, contributing to the prosperity and religious landscape too. Very much like us, they too took with them their language, culture, and most importantly, their religion. But that's not the secret.
With its exciting blend of East and West, old and new, Thailand draws millions of tourists annually. Aside from limitless sightseeing options and friendly, hospitable people, for Hindu tourists, the country offers a fascinating added dimension. Although Thailand is 95% Buddhist today, it has a thriving Hindu community with many temples across the country. Naturally imbued with an open-minded and tolerant nature, Thai people respect and welcome all faiths. They especially revere India as the birthplace of the Buddha and have incorporated many Hindu emblems and rituals into everyday life. The long-standing connection between Thailand and Hinduism is most apparent in the ancient city of Ayutthaya. Situated approximately 60 kilometers north of Bangkok, this once golden and glittering city was named after Ayodhya, the sacred birthplace of Lord Ram. Like its namesake, both kingdoms are situated on the banks of a river. Both have a magnificently glorious past, and both have been surrounded by political intrigue, betrayals, and invasions. Rich in artistic refinement and architectural treasures, Ayutthaya has more than 1,700 gold-leafed palaces, temples, and monasteries. Unsurprisingly, merchants, missionaries, and adventurers from every corner of the globe were mesmerized by the city's rich and opulent beauty.
Ayutthaya was founded in 1350. It was located in the middle of what we call Suvarnabhumi region. Suvarnabhumi means the land of gold, and was located with the equal distance of India and China. That's why it became the hub of commercial and diplomatic societies within this region.
The Sanskrit translation for the word Ayutthaya is not to be warred against. It's ironic then that the city's illustrious 400-year rule was tragically ended when it was brutally sacked and destroyed by neighboring armies in the 18th century. Monasteries and palaces were plundered on a large scale, and citizens were forced to abandon the city, resulting in its collapse. Despite the crumbling archaeological ruins, Ayutthaya today remains awe-inspiring, and its historical park has been recognized as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Many young Thais visit the city today, which is still a source of great national pride. Pilgrimages are undertaken as a means of honoring ancestors, as well as to recollect the city's past splendor.
I think the whole country is proud of Ayutthaya, and when you go to school as a student, you have to learn about our city, and you have to learn about Ayutthaya as, you know, our main capital city in the old time. And the school take trips from everywhere to travel in Ayutthaya. So I think young people are interested in Ayutthaya, and now it becomes hipper to travel around these ruins and, you know, to see where you're from, and to see the ruins and to appreciate the values of Buddhism, the values of the cities.
Along with the countless relics and treasures that went up in flames when the ancient capital fell, were written records of the Ramayana. This Hindu epic had long been a source of inspiration to the Siamese kings of Ayutthaya. Several years later, when Bangkok was established as the new capital of the country, one of the first actions of King Chulalok the Great was to build the spectacularly ornate Grand Palace, the Temple of the Emerald Buddha. He also oversaw a new translation and composition of the Ramayana, or Ramkian, as it is commonly known in Thailand. The king was so inspired by the story of Lord Ram, seeing him as all that a just and valiant ruler should be, that he divinized himself as a savior and avatar of the Thai people by adopting the name Ram for himself. These stunning Ramkian murals on the walls of the Grand Palace were painted during the reign of his successor, King Ram III. We see in these vividly depicted images the legendary story of Prince Ram, his loving wife Sita, and their adventures following her abduction and rescue from the demon king Ravan. Although the images are of the Ramayana, these have been adapted to a Thai context in terms of clothing, weaponry, and the scenery. Hindus traveling to the Grand Palace and the ancient ruins of Ayutthaya will leave feeling reconnected to their own wonderful epics. These redefined and deeply cultured tourist destinations in exquisitely beautiful Thai settings can have few equals. Welcome back. Yes, back home to South Africa, back to our traditions, our own nuances, and our own ways of worship. Carried over from our holy land, the ancient practice of firewalking is still very much alive today. We join the Belvedere Draupadi Temple as devotees perform this sacred act across glowing coals with utmost faith and reverence.
This prayer was done at home. It was done as a family prayer at the Maestri's home. And I used to go into a trance of Lord Murga. And initially, I started the firewalking at home. As we progressed through the prayer, it started getting bigger and bigger, where we could not cater for the community and for the number of people there. So we had to move it to a public ground where the community can also participate. Draupadi Amman firewalking prayer comes from the great epic of the Mahabharata. She is the wife of Arjun, and she was disgraced in the royal court by Duryodhan, who is Arjun's cousin brother, who was envious of the fact that Arjun had married Draupadi. And because he disrobed her, Krishna, who is a brother, didn't allow that to happen and gave her more and more sari to wear, so that she wasn't disturbed at any time. But the people around there didn't believe this. And to prove her chastity and to prove her innocence, she had taken a vow that she will walk on a red bed of coal to prove to everybody her innocence.
And her devotees that have taken on this venture have done so by a means of showing devotion to her and by proving that we are able to fast the 18 days and observe the 18 days and ultimately offer themselves to her and show that Mother Draupadi, we have fasted these 18 days and we offer this worship to you.
The devotees actually pay homage to Mother Draupadi Amman by carrying the gargams. The gargam is symbolic and it represents the crown of the Divine Mother, telling her mother that you are the queen of the universe, and they pay homage to her.
It contains five different liquids, which represents five different elements, life-giving elements. It is decorated and beautified, and you will notice that there's a face on the gargam representing her face. The Divine Mother's face, ultimately as a symbol of her crown.
When we start the Gargam prayer, it is a havan that is done by the priest. Then we have a Urikushalambu group, and we have the tiger drummers who give the vibrations to the devotees and put them into that spirit of Mother Draupadi. We have those who get into a trance. The trances are invoked and they are pierced. The gargams are carried, it is taken on a short route and brought down to the fire pit.
Oh.
community has just taken a fantastic approach to the prayer and have joined us, and it's just grown from a simple house a prayer amongst the family, and it's just grown amongst the community.
We had taken the sacred fire from the temple down to the fire pit, and we ignited the fire. Not everybody and anybody is allowed into the fire pit, because the devotees go through an 18-day very strict fast in reverence of this mother.
When they stand there at the beginning of that fire pit and they look across it and they see her, and all they see is her, the fire that's before them will bring them no harm. It is a test of their faith as well as a show of their devotion to her, thus resulting in them being easily able to cross the fire. So I think the fire you go through and you come across being pure and showing that it's a spiritual cleansing.
Knowingly or unknowingly, we're human, we do make mistakes, and prayer to Lord Muruga and Mother Draupadi will most certainly, she will give them her mercy, she'll shower her mercy upon them.
These festivals and prayers is what will draw us closer, keeping us away from negative activities that one should not be taking part of.
We hope we've tantalized your taste buds with our new look, new feel, Sadhna. It's just a taste of what's to come for the rest of the series as we bring you more of Hindu lifestyle, tradition, art, culture, and music. Remember, Sadhna, the Inward Path, on Saturdays at 11:30 on SABC 3. Until next week, keep up the Sadhna. Jai Mata Di. Namaskaram and welcome to Sadhna, the Inward Path. Yes, it's a new series and new beginnings, and what better way to start than with the ushering in of a new year. We also take Sadhna to the doggies with a peek into a seva project in New Delhi, then celebrate the lessons of our glorious Hinduism by putting principles into practice with a march steeped in history. The new year brings with it new hope, a fresh start, and ample opportunities for a better life. Puthanda, the Tamil New Year, falls in mid-April on the Gregorian calendar. Sadhna celebrated the birth of the new year with the Tamil Federation of Gauteng in Linasia.
This year marks 5115. The meaning of this year is, in Tamil they would say Jaya Paradam, which means the year of victory.
This new year for us celebrates a new beginning. Just as the English New Year for us is a new beginning for the year, This is a new beginning for everything. And I think for us as Tamilians and Hindus that, you know, we need to prioritize this as well, because this is our culture, this is where we come from. I think this should take precedence over the English or the Western New Year. But I think this is a very momentous occasion because it's also one occasion that brings us together as a community. Our culture particularly has not been really polluted. It is really pure. Even if you look at just the words, there's nothing that has been changed from 5,000 years back up to this present date. The words are as is, the language is as is. The way we perform things in the temple, music, dance, the way it has been done and the way it has been written 5,000 years ago is the way that we still practice it.
We have got local teachers, we have got local talent, and the Tamil Federation wants to give leadership in this, where we can get teachers more, better equipped, give them the resources of teaching and give them the support structures. Once all that is in place, it would be easy to transcend into the language being taught.
Victory for us as Tamil people, accomplishment in unity. So let's stop sitting back. Let's all make our little input into our society.
What happens today is, firstly, we have all the musicians and the dancers who are coming together under one umbrella. What we did was we've asked each of our affiliates to give us two items, and they've chose obviously the music and the dance. I think the important thing for us today is that you got young and old who are coming together to share the stage.
Aliyam Thoruvadu Salavam Nandru. It is a saying that means to pray in a temple is good. Well, it doesn't necessarily mean that praying in your home is not good, but it means that praying in a temple and worshipping in a temple is good, because we come together in a temple and we give off all our energies and contribute to one source where everybody can benefit.
Atma, or soul, found in every living being is a manifestation of divinity itself. To see and serve God in his different forms is indeed the mark of an ardent bhakta. This was the inspiration behind Mudita Chandra, a young lady who helps run the Sai Animal Welfare Ashram in Delhi that is home to over 300 abandoned and abused dogs.
Hi, you guys. Hi, you guys.
Oh, jo bachche.
Brahman and Atman, the supreme creator and the individual soul, are the two pillars on which the whole edifice of Hindu philosophy rests, where the supreme being embodies itself in all of creation, in nature, in man, and even in dogs.
I basically have loved dogs my entire life, since I was maybe 4 or 5, and I've always had animals come to me, come to my house, they come to eat, they come, you know, if they're on their last legs, they'll come for medical care, they'll come just to drink water, for medication, for love. I find dogs to be just pure unconditional love, and I also think that they connect you to a part of yourself that a lot of us, you know, in your day-to-day life, you get a bit disconnected from. And I think they continually bring you back to yourself, which I love. And if I'm ever in a bad mood or feeling low or anything, I just hang out with dogs. Or, like, have you seen how a dog eats his bone or his meal or whatever? You know, they really relish each moment. If they're sleeping, they're just in la-la land. If you look at them, they're like babies. You know, they remember being connected to pure source and, you know, pure connection, which I really like. I found this place because I think I always wanted a shelter of my own, and I ended up meeting the gentleman who ran the shelter during a protest rally where they were killing animals in Bangalore. They were killing dogs, killing them in very abominable ways, where, you know, they were stringing them up, hanging them on trees, injecting them with poison, which made them die a very slow and horrible death because it went in very slowly and made their hearts explode. So I met the gentleman who ran this shelter then, and he told me that he ran this place, and I had a dog at that time who somebody had abandoned, and she used to cry a lot. So he told me, why don't you bring her here? So I brought her here and she was perfectly fine. I think she just wanted company, she wanted dog company. And I used to come here gradually, you know, whenever I could. And I'd help out, I loved feeding the dogs, and I'd bring them bones and things to chew on and biscuits and things like that. And then he died at the end of the year, the gentleman who ran the shelter. And when he died, there was no one really to look after the shelter, because even though his family loves dogs and things, they're not as involved, you know. They're a great source of help now to us because they help us with the staff salaries, a lot of other expenses. They do it in the memory of their father. But as a rule, you know, on the day-to-day running, there was no one really there. And we had some volunteers who came in, but...